Okay. My wife and I began our journey to financial freedom in 1989, and it was during a home Bible study where we watched 20 videos entitled Financial Freedom. And this is a video series put out by the Institute on Basic Life Principles. Over the weeks, as we watched those, I felt the Holy Spirit convicting me of His desire for me to trust the Lord to start walking in His ways in the area of finances. Well, I couldn't make that commitment because I knew the minute I did, I'd have some unexpected expense and I'd have to put it on a credit card. Well, the first commitment was no new debt, so I couldn't make that. But over the weeks, the Holy Spirit would not let go. I called Him the Hound of Heaven. He just pursued me until I finally said, okay, Lord, I don't know how we're going to do this, but I'll commit no new debt and begin to work to get out of debt. Well, through His faithfulness, we saw Him work in unbelievable ways as to how anticipated expenses were always less than we thought they would be. Before, they'd always been more than we expected, and now they were less. Things that broke down frequently tended not to break down so frequently and didn't have to be fixed. It was amazing. And through His faithfulness, He enabled us to become completely debt-free, including our mortgage, in 7 years. So in September 1996, we became completely debt-free. Well, we wanted to find a way to share what we had learned, other than through 20 weeks of videos. And in December of 97, the church came to us and asked if we would consider becoming leaders of the Crown Financial Ministries. And we said, certainly, and we took the training class, and then in January of 1998, we started teaching Crown Financial Ministries. It was it originally started out as a 12-week Bible study, both practical applications and scriptural teaching as to what the scriptures had to say on finances. And we did that for 15 years. In 1995, I created a seminar, which this is part of. I entitled it Out From Under. Actually, it was my wife's idea, and God's Biblical Principles of Finance. And it was a six week class. That's what it was, and so I gave that 7 or 8 times at our church. Then when we came here, of course, we're grounded in God's Biblical Principles of Finance because we've been following them since 1989. So what, that 28 years, and we know they work. When they asked me to teach on that for the new members, they were asking me to take 7 hours of material and get it down to 1. Well, that wasn't going to work very well, and it still hasn't. For this, I came up with the 4 topics that I thought were the most important of the 7. But unfortunately, and then I started shortening them, and I got 3 of them down to about an hour. But the 4th one is still an hour. In fact, I actually lengthened it from about 45 minutes to an hour because as I tried to shorten it, I kept thinking of things that needed to be added to it. And unfortunately, that one's on giving, and we're not going to cover that today. Today, we're going to cover the other 3. We're going to look at God's biblical principles for financial freedom. In Hosea 4:6, God says that my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. Disobedience to or ignorance of God's principles is a frequent cause of financial problems. Well, how do we become financially free? Jesus said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." And what is the truth? Again, Jesus said, "Thy word is truth." But does God's word really have that much to say about finances? Several years ago, Howard Dayton, the CEO of Crown Financial Ministries, and his friend Jim Seneff did a complete thorough study of the scriptures, categorizing scriptures according to topics. And what they discovered is that there were approximately 500 verses on prayer, fewer than 500 verses on faith, but there were over 2,350 verses on handling money and possessions. So that begs the question, why does the Bible have so much to say about money? It's because how we handle our money impacts our relationship with the Lord. Luke 16:11, Jesus said, "If therefore you have not been faithful with the use of worldly wealth, who will entrust the true riches to you?" And similarly, in Matthew 25:21, "Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." See, Jesus is equating how we handle our money with the quality of our spiritual life. And if we handle our money according to God's principles, our fellowship with Christ will be closer. But if we are unfaithful in managing our money according to His principles, our fellowship with Him will suffer. And that's true in, let's face it, every area of life, not just finances, but in every area of life. God has, it says, "I have a plan for you." Well, it's laid out in His scriptures, whether it be our marriages, whether it be raising children, whether it be handling money. He has a way to do it. And if we walk in His ways, our fellowship with Him becomes closer. And if we don't, we get separated from Him. You see, possessions are the primary competitor with Jesus for the lordship of our lives. In Matthew 6:24, Jesus said, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will hold to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money." During your normal week, how much time do you spend earning money on your job, making decisions on how to spend money, thinking about where to save and invest, praying about your giving? The Lord knew that we would spend a significant amount of our time around money and possessions. And He has prepared us for the task of handling it properly by giving us the Bible, His blueprint for living. Now, there are two economic systems operating in the world today. We have man's economy and we have God's economy. Man's economy, what makes us content? It's more stuff, just a little bit more. Whereas God's economy equates contentment with freedom. If we are free, we will be content. In man's economy, we have an attitude of self-gratification. Whereas in God's economy, our attitude is one of self-denial. Man's economy, our attitude is, "It's mine, I earned it." But in God's economic system, our attitude should be, "It's God's, He provided it." Similarly, in man's economy, we have the attitude, "It's mine, I can do with it as I please." But in God's economic system, everything is God's, and I am to manage it as He would. Man's economic system says it's okay to borrow as long as I can make those easy monthly payments. But in God's economic system, borrowing places us in bondage to the lender. The result is we have financial bondage under man's economy and financial freedom under God's economic system. And as we look at this, we see that the world's way of doing things from God is 180 degrees, and that shouldn't surprise us. In Isaiah 55:8-9, God says, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts your thoughts." God further tells us in 1 Corinthians 3:19 that the wisdom of this world is foolishness to Him. In 1 Corinthians 2:14-16, Paul writes, "A natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually appraised. But we have the mind of Christ." You know, the Bible claims that all Scripture is inspired by the Spirit of God. And according to the 1 Corinthians 2 passage, only those who are spiritual can understand what the Spirit of God has authored. I mean, that's telling us that unless you are born again, become a spiritual man, you can't accept or understand God's thoughts. And you know, we struggle this with everyday life with unbelievers as to why they're the way they are. It's because they're not spiritual beings. They're natural men only. Well, the topics of discussion that are in your book is God's role in finances, our role in finances, giving, and debt. Now, as I said, we're only going to cover three of these today. Today we're going to do the first two and the last. I encourage you greatly on your own to go through the giving one. It's the same size as everything else we're going to go through today, so that's why we can't cover all of it. Now, the first two items, God's role and our role, these are the foundational pillars for all of God's biblical financial principles. Unless you grasp and accept these, the rest of the stuff doesn't make a lot of sense. But when you look at everything else from God's role and our role, things make a lot of sense. And it's easier to come up with financial decisions when you look at them from this perspective. As you study the scriptures that deal with financial matters, it becomes apparent that God has divided the responsibilities. He has retained certain responsibilities, and he has delegated other responsibilities to us. In Scripture, God calls himself by more than 250 names. And the name that best describes God's part in the area of money is Master. There are four facets to God's position as Master: his ownership, his control, his provision, and his dispensing of possessions. So take a look at his ownership. Recognizing God's ownership is crucial if we are to allow him to be the Lord of our money and possessions. Psalm 24:1 says, "The earth is the Lord and all it contains, the world and those who dwell in it." And 1 Chronicles 29:11 says, "Everything in the heavens and earth is yours, O Lord." In Luke 14:33, it reads, "So therefore, no one of you can be my disciple who does not give up all his possessions." And then again, Matthew 6:24, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will hold to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon," or money. Now, as we see from these passages, to be true followers of Christ, we must transfer ownership of our possessions to the Lord. Jesus is talking about a heart attitude here toward material things. We cannot serve two masters. We cannot serve both Christ and money. And it's easy to say in our heads that we're transferring the ownership of our stuff to him, but it's another thing to really do it in your heart. And I believe that God will test you to see if you have truly, in your heart, given him possessions. And that test could be that he will take what's most dear to us. It could be our job, our car, our house, our children. You know, the most vivid example of this in the scriptures is found in Genesis 22, when God commanded Abraham to offer up his only son Isaac as a burnt offering. When Abraham obeyed, demonstrating his willingness to give up his dearest possession, God responded, "Do not stretch out your hand against the lad, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." When we acknowledge God to be the owner, every spending decision becomes a spiritual decision. We no longer ask the Lord what we should do with our money. Rather, we ask him what we should do with his money. Part of the process of learning to be content is to recognize the Lord's ownership. If you believe that you own a possession, then the circumstances that surround that possession will be reflected in your attitude. As an example, how would you feel if you're out driving your car and somebody runs a red light and smashes into your car, and they don't have any insurance? Well, compare that to how you might feel if that car that you were driving wasn't yours, and your car at home was fine. So you would have you're going to be upset, but you're not going to have the same attitude as if that's mine. No, it's the Lord's car, and it's the Lord's money that's going to fix it, not yours. Okay, the second aspect of his role as master is control. 1 Chronicles 29:11. We adore you as being in control of everything. Psalm 135:6. Whatever the Lord does, he pleases. Whatever the Lord pleases, he does, in heaven and in earth, in the seas and in all the deeps. And Isaiah 45:6-7. I am the Lord, and there is no other, the one forming light and creating darkness, causing well-being and creating calamity. I am the Lord who does all these. Again, Scripture plainly tells us that God is in control of every event that occurs on the earth. And he's in control not only of good circumstances, but also the difficult circumstances. Proverbs 21:1. The king's heart is like channels of water in the hands of the Lord. He turns it wherever he wishes. 1 Chronicles 29:12. Your hand controls power and might, and it is at your discretion that men are made great and given strength. God is not only in control of circumstances, but he is also in control of people, as we see from this passage in Exodus. But I will harden Pharaoh's heart, that I may multiply my signs and my wonders in the land of Egypt. And of course, Romans 8:28. We know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God, to those who are called according to his purposes. Now, the third aspect of his role as master is his provision. The Lord promises to provide for our needs. Philippians 4:19. And my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. You know, the same Lord that fed the manna to the children of Israel in the wilderness and did not allow their shoes to wear out is the same Lord who fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And it's the same Lord who provided for Elijah in the wilderness by commanding the ravens to take him bread and meat twice a day. And this is the same Lord who has promised to provide for our needs. Now, God is both predictable and unpredictable. He is absolutely predictable in his faithfulness to provide for our needs. What we cannot predict is how or when the Lord will provide. Now, because God is absolutely faithful in providing for our needs, when we find ourselves without the resources to meet our needs, we must ask ourselves, what did I spend it on? You see, I believe that because God knows in advance what our needs are going to be, he will oftentimes provide for those needs in advance. The issue is, what do we do with those resources he has provided in advance? Do we treat that as a windfall and spend it on unnecessary desires? Or do we save it to meet future needs, either ours or perhaps somebody else's? Do we even think to ask God why he provided these resources? Now, since God has promised to provide our needs, we need to know the difference between a need and a want. A lot of us want a lot of things and think they're needs. Well, 1 Timothy says, and if we have food and covering with these, we shall be content. So what is that including? Well, it's a basic necessity of life. And it's food, clothing, and shelter. Everything else is a need. I'm sorry, it's a want. Yeah. Now, the Lord may have allow us to have our wants fulfilled, but he has not promised to provide them. You know, we create some, I don't want to say this, false needs, in that they were never a need to begin with, but because we went ahead and did something, borrowed the money to buy something, okay, now we have to maintain it. So now we have a need to maintain something that we shouldn't have bought in the first place. We have a need to make the monthly payments, which in many cases will be 2 to 3 times more until it's paid off than what you actually paid for an item. I call those false needs. Okay, the fourth aspect of his role as master is dispensing of possessions. God dispenses possessions to whomever and in what quantity he chooses. And this is illustrated by the following verses from Matthew and Jeremiah. In the parable of the talents, Matthew wrote, "And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, each according to his own ability." Now, I don't know about you, but this is a freeing thought to me. God does not give us more than what he knows we're capable of handling. And he doesn't hold us accountable for more than what he gives us. Jeremiah 27:5, "I have made the earth, the men and the beasts which are on the face of the earth, by my great power and by my outstretched arm, and I will give it to the one who is pleasing in my sight." You know, thinking about that, that God dispenses the possessions. You know, oftentimes we see a friend or a neighbor who's got something that we really, you know, God should have given me that. I deserved that. Well, if you would have deserved it, God would have given it to you. If he knew you could handle it, he would have given it to you. But he knows contrary to that. And so he gives it to somebody else. But we have to keep in mind, you know, God's not being fair, unfair. He's actually being fair. He's not entrusting you with something you can't handle. Now, you might be able to, and as we'll see later on, through showing faithfulness, you may be able to handle down the road something that you aren't capable of handling today. Okay, the second pillar is our role in finances. Now, the word in the Bible that best describes our role in the area of finances is steward. In the Bible, the position of steward is one of great responsibility. The steward is the supreme authority under the master, and has full responsibility for all of the master's possessions and household affairs. As a steward, we have one responsibility, to be faithful. 1 Corinthians 4:2 says, "Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful." Well, I ask this question, faithful to who? To the master. Well, what is a steward? Some would define a steward to be a manager, possibly an overseer, or a supervisor. The American Heritage Dictionary defines a steward as one who manages another's property, finances, or other affairs. Also, as one in charge of the household affairs of a large estate. Now, there's a significant difference in the definitions of the steward of biblical times and a money manager of today. For example, if you hired a money manager to handle your investments, you know, he would meet with you to determine your needs and your goals, and then he would manage your assets in any legal way he deems fit to in order to meet those goals and needs. However, the steward in biblical time was one who was more like what we would have today as one who has a general power of attorney. He has full authority to do anything the master would do, but he cannot do anything the master would not do. He's literally standing in his shoes. And so, as a steward, we have to take that into consideration. Not only is it what we're going to do or what we're going to buy or what we're going to spend on, is this something the Lord would have us do, or is this something the Lord would not do? Because if he wouldn't do it, we're his steward, and therefore we should not do it. Now, there are two components of our responsibility to be faithful. We are to be faithful with what we are given, and we're to be faithful with 100%. The parable of the talents found in Matthew 25 highlights 4 principles of faithfulness. The first is, we are given responsibilities based upon our abilities. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, each according to his own ability. The second principle is that we will be held accountable for what was entrusted to us. Verse 19, "Now after a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. The third principle of faithfulness is that we will be rewarded based upon our faithfulness. Verses 20 through 27. And the one who received the five talents, his master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one also who had received the one talent came up. But his master answered and said to him, The one also who had received the two talents came up, and his master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one also who had received the one talent came up. But his master answered and said to him, "You wicked, lazy slave. You knew that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have put my money in the bank, and on my arrival, I would have received my money back with interest." The fourth principle of faithfulness is that when we prove to be faithful with smaller responsibilities, we will be given larger responsibilities. Verses 28 through 29. "Therefore, take away the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he shall have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, even what he does have shall be taken away." The Lord rewards faithfulness, regardless of the amount over which we are responsible. We are required to be faithful whether we are given much or little. Hudson Taylor, the founder of the China Inland Mission, once said that small things are small things, but faithfulness with a small thing is a big thing. Now, we're to be faithful with 100% of our possessions, our time, and our talent. We are not only required to be faithful with what we are given, but required to be faithful with all of it, not just 10%. Because God owns it all, we will be held accountable for 100% of what he entrusts to us, not just the 10% tithe. In the area of finance, the church is concentrated on teaching what God has to say about handling 10% of our income. And as a side, I think they've done a lousy job of that. But has allowed the body of Christ to learn how to handle the other 90% from the world's perspective. As a result of not having a biblical perspective on how to handle money, many Christians have developed wrong attitudes toward possessions, with the result that they make incorrect financial decisions and many suffer painful consequences. Now, here's three additional principles of faithfulness. First, if we waste possessions, the Lord will remove us. Luke 16, 1 through 2. Now, he was saying to the disciples, "There was a certain rich man who had a steward, and this steward was reported to him as squandering his possessions. And he called him and said to him, 'What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be steward.'" Now, this passage has two principles that are applicable to us. First, when we waste our possessions, this becomes public knowledge and creates a poor testimony. And second, the Lord will remove us as steward if we squander what he has given us. A second one, principle is faithfulness in little things is foundational. Luke 16:10. "He who is faithful in a very little thing is faithful also in much. And he who is unrighteous in a very little thing is unrighteous also in much." If we have the character to be faithful with small things, the Lord knows he can trust us with bigger responsibilities. And the third is faithfulness with another's possessions. Luke 16:12. "And if you have not been faithful in the use of that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own?" Are you faithful with others' possessions? Are you careless with your employer's office supplies? When you borrow something from a friend, do you return it in at least as good a condition as when you got it? To summarize, There are four primary benefits of handling money faithfully. We have a more intimate fellowship with Christ. In Matthew 25, 21, we saw the reward the master gave for faithfulness. His master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." As we are faithful with our possessions, we enter into a closer relationship with Christ. Secondly, it develops our character. We spend money on the things that are most important to us, and therefore, you can tell more about a person's character by examining his checkbook than by listening to him speak. Money molds people through the processes of getting it, spending it, saving it, and giving it. Are you the master of your money, or is it mastering you? Third, we can learn to be content. Once we know and understand God's role, and then faithfully execute our role, we can be content. Remember, God owns everything, is in control of every circumstance, promises to provide for our needs, and dispenses his possessions as he sees fit. And lastly, we can get our finances in order. As we apply the principles of Scripture to our finances, we will begin to get out of debt, spend more wisely, start saving for our future goals, and give even more to the Lord's work. Now, I need you to turn back to page 40. And we're going to look at debt. How many of you remember this old bumper sticker? I owe, it's off to work, I go. Unfortunately, far too many Americans, this bumper sticker accurately depicts their way of life. Let's take a look at consumer debt. Now, consumer debt is all debt owed by individuals except for their home mortgages. So, the outstanding consumer debt at the end of 2016 was $3.75 trillion, a 57% increase in the last 10 years. You know, these numbers are so big, it's really hard for anybody to really grasp how much they are. I mean, you know, if they put all the zeros up there, it might have more significance, but they always do it this way. It makes it look smaller than it is. But let me give you an example of how big this debt is. Suppose you could convert this $3.75 trillion into $1 bills, and you counted them out at the rate of 3 per second, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And you did that 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. At the end of the first year, you would have counted out $94,608,000. At the end of 10 years, you would have counted out $946,080,000. After 1,000 years, you would have counted out $94,608,000,000. If you had started at the time of creation 6,000 years ago, you would have counted out only $567,648,000,000. It would actually take you 39,637 years to count out $3.75 trillion. Now, the U.S. debt is obviously much worse. At the end of the year, we owed basically $20 trillion in debt that the U.S. government was in, which in the last 10 years is a 130% increase. So see, 10 years ago, the U.S. debt was around $8 trillion. In 2016, the interest on the debt. Now the interest rate, the average interest rate on the U.S. debt was 2.16%. That was $432 billion a year in interest. That's $1.2 billion a day, or $13,719 a second. And that's just the interest on the debt. Now, how many of you in here remember when interest rates, I mean savings account interest rates were 5%. Yeah, okay. See, young people don't have to revise these numbers because the rates have been so low for so long, but we remember that. Well, think what would happen if the U.S. debt, if the interest rates go up and the U.S. debt went from 2.16 back to 5, which it was for years. The interest would be $1 trillion a year. And to be honest about it, it's the Fed manipulating it so the rates don't go up. And how do they do it? They buy the debt. So the Federal Reserve is buying the U.S. debt to keep the interest rates down because there's nothing they could do if the interest rates went back up to 5%. Well, as you can see from these statistics, America is spinning out of control and we're drowning in a sea of debt. Well, what is debt exactly? Well, it's money or property which one person is obligated to pay to another. It consists of money owed to credit card companies, bank loans other than your mortgages, money borrowed from relatives, and then home mortgages is included. That's all that is debt. What's the true cost of debt? Well, we have two. We have a financial cost, and we have a physical cost of debt. Let's take a look at the financial cost. If you maintained a balance of $5,560 on a credit card that was at 18% interest rate, this would cost you $1,000 of interest annually, so that after 40 years, you would have paid $40,000 in interest. From this next chart, we're going to see what lenders have known for a long time, the incredible impact of compounding interest. And I can't remember who it was that called compounding interest the eighth wonder of the world. I can't remember, somebody did it, but here's why. The lender will accumulate $4,163,213 if you pay him $1,000 a year for 40 years and he's earning 18%. So you paid him $40,000 and he's made $4 million. Do you still wonder why you get all those pre-approved credit cards? You know, the other trick is to give you low introductory rates, hoping that you'll run up enough charges that when the time comes to make the payments, you won't be able to pay off the card, but you're going to start paying that interest because you're going to start accumulating the interest. Now let's see what would happen if you had invested that $1,000 a year for 40 years at 5%. You would have accumulated $120,800. Now, many may say, well, we couldn't get 5% this day. Well, and that's not true. You can. Yeah, you can't get it at the bank, that's for sure, and you can't get it on government debts, that's for sure, but you can get it in mutual funds. Even with the market fall by 50% that took place in 2008-2009, counting that, the market has recovered. It's still earning over 8% a year for the last 10-20 years. The key there is when you get out, and when you get out, you don't want to have to get out when the market's lost 50%. You want to be able to stay the course. Now, if you could invested that at 10%, you could have earned $486,850. And that's just, remember, we're talking $1,000 a year for 40 years. If you could set that aside. Debt has a much higher cost than most of us realize. So the next time you're tempted to purchase something with debt, ask yourself if the short-term benefits of the purchase outweigh the long-term costs of the debt. Now let's take a look at a home mortgage. If you have a 30-year mortgage for $150,000 at a rate of 4%, your monthly payment would be $716.12. Over the 30 years, you will have paid $257,804.26. $107,000 more than what you borrowed. Now, if you could up your monthly payment by just $50, your total outlay would be $242,662. And you would have saved $15,142.24 in interest expense. And you would have paid off the loan in 26 years and 3 months instead of 30 years. I mean, that's the impact. That's why the savings is because you're not taking 30 years, you're taking 26 years and 3 months. And if you could up the payment by $100, you would pay $231,000. You would save $26,022.84. And it would take you 23 and a half years to pay off the loan. Like I say, readjusting these numbers with more realistic rates. You know, when I first did these, which was back in the mid-90s, you know, I was using 7% for a mortgage loan. Well, the numbers were staggering when you're looking at 7%. Not near so much as with 4, but it's still significant savings to be had. Yeah, the extra payment would all go to principal, and that's so your interest is going down. Correct. What you need to do, it'll automatically do that, but you need to verify if you're going to do it that there aren't any prepayment penalties, because some mortgages have a penalize you if you prepay the loan. So you've got to make sure you don't have any prepayment penalties. Okay, let's take a look at the physical cost of debt. Increases stress, which leads to mental, physical, and emotional fatigue. It stifles creativity. For example, if there's something you want to buy, you don't have the money for it, and you go out and borrow the debt, you don't even think about, were there other alternatives? Is there other ways of doing this? You could have had a garage sale, perhaps, and raised the funds to buy what you wanted to buy. Other things, maybe get a second job, maybe create a job out of the home to raise the funds to acquire these things. But when you go into debt, it eliminates it. You don't even think about that there's other possibilities. It harms relationships. Now, this is a biggie. Borrowing money from a friend or relative results in a change in your relationship. You have now become debtor and creditor. Frequently, we will borrow from friends or relatives because it appears to be a win-win situation. After all, you will probably be paying them a lower rate of interest than you would be paying a financial institution, and at the same time, they will be receiving a higher rate of interest than they would get from a financial institution. So it appears you both win. But what happens if your circumstances change and you're no longer able to meet all of your financial obligations? Who's going to get shorted? Your family or the bank? Who's going to foreclose? Who's going to repossess the car or whatever? I think in every case, the family is the one that you're going to stop making the payments to so you can make these payments over here. And if that goes on for any length of time, there's a real possibility of a change in your attitude within the family, especially yours. You're not even going to want to look them in the eye because you know you owe them this money and you haven't been paying on it. And it's huge. Well, we looked at, you know, physical and financial costs on debt and stuff like that, but this is a biblical principles of finance. So what does the Bible have to say about debt? Well, I want us to take a look at several translations of Romans 13. From the King James, it says, owe to no man anything. It's Romans 13:8. In the NAS, it's owe nothing to anyone. The NIV says, let no debt remain outstanding. The Living Bible says, pay all your debts. The Amplified Bible translates this as keep out of debt and owe no man anything. Strong's Exhaustive Concordance further amplifies this message as it says, owe to no one, no, not anything, no, nothing at all. The verse further states that the only thing we are to owe to one another is love. Now, we're going to take a look at several consequences of borrowing. Proverbs 22:7 says, borrowing produces bondage to creditors. The rich rules over the poor, and the borrower becomes the lender's slave. Deuteronomy 28:15 and 43 and 44 says that it is a curse for disobedience. But it shall come about, if you will not obey the Lord your God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes with which I charge you today, that all these curses shall come upon you and overtake you. The alien who is among you shall rise above you higher and higher, but you shall go down lower and lower. He shall lend to you, but you shall not lend to him. He shall be the head, and you shall be the tail. This is true not only individually, but I think it's true for nations. Take a look at where the United States is today as far as where the alien is in relationship to the United States, as far as prestige, etc. I mean, you know, they lord it over us because we owe them money. China is the biggest borrower country. Okay, another consequence of borrowing, according to James chapter 4, is that it presumes upon the future. James 4:13 through 14, "Come now, you who say today or tomorrow, we shall go to such and such a city and spend a year there and do business and make a profit. Yet you do not know what life will be like tomorrow." Similarly, in Proverbs 27:1, "Do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day may bring forth." When we go into debt, we assume that our job will continue and that our business or investments will continue to be profitable. Another consequence of borrowing is that it may deny God an opportunity to provide or protect. You know, sometimes God tries to protect us, but not providing the funds to buy something. If we borrow and buy the thing anyway, we have removed his protection from us. Also, when we borrow, we aren't giving God the opportunity to demonstrate his supernatural power. Another consequence is it evades self-examination. When God withholds funds, there's a good reason, and it's a signal for us to reevaluate our lives, our plans for the money, and our faith in him. Borrowing evades these purposes and allows us to continue on in our own wisdom and efforts. Borrowing removes barriers to harmful items, and we kind of looked at that back on that. It provides God an opportunity to provide. Another consequence is it demonstrates discontent with the basics. God has promised to provide food, clothing, and shelter. And according to the 1 Timothy passage we looked at, he wants us to be content with these. It devours resources through high interest payments. Most people do not comprehend the actual price tag of using someone else's money. We are taught to think in terms of monthly payments. Those who borrow money tend to look upon the interest as a small amount, but actually the interest payments constitute a very large part of the total cost, usually, depending on the length of the loan, it can be more than what you borrowed in the first place. Another consequence of borrowing is it promotes impulse buying. God expects us to perfectly consider our decisions regarding the management of funds which he provides. However, the world encourages buyers to make impulsive decisions based on the desires of the moment. Easy access to money lends itself to impulsive purchases. So before you buy, ask yourself, do I need this? I mean, isn't this what advertising is all about? It's to make you discontent and to promote impulse buying. Another consequence is that it weakens personal faith. A Christian who relies on credit does not feel that he needs to trust God during the most critical time of the decision making. He is convinced that if he can afford the monthly payments, he can buy the item. There is no attempt to discern God's will. A clear evidence of God's will can be obtained by trusting God to provide the funds ahead of time. This is the kind of faith that pleases God. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Borrowing also excludes help from others. God uses the needs in the life of one Christian and the abundance in the life of another to bring them together in Christian fellowship. The one with the abundance is given grace to distribute to the need of the saints, and the one who receives is filled with joy and gratefulness because of God's grace through the giver. When you, on your own, when you go through the giving one, you'll run into the cycle of giving diagram in there. That's what this is talking about. Another consequence, it causes overspending. It is a fact that credit card users buy one-third more than those who pay cash. Even if they pay off the card every month, they will buy more than they would have had they paid cash. Overspending is destructive in itself. However, when overspending produces pressures and conflicts which damage family relationships, it is especially destructive. Money problems are the primary cause of divorce, and studies show that most arguments in the home center around money. Well, are there any? How many biblical examples are there where God uses debt as a way to provide a blessing to someone? Zero. How? Although there are examples where God has supernaturally intervened in order to free someone of the burden and bondage of debt. The widow in 2 Kings chapter 4, where I think it's Elijah or Elisha. I can't remember which one. Elisha, I think. You know, and they fill the things with oil because her sons were going to be taken into prison, you know, because they couldn't pay the debts. There are no examples given in Scripture where God uses debt in any positive way. Debt is always viewed as a negative. Well, biblical examples of how God uses debt as a way to complete his projects. Again, zero, and I think that's pretty obviously, especially when we saw that debt's always deemed a negative. However, there are several examples where God provides the resources for his projects in advance. In Exodus chapter 12, verses 35 through 36, we see how God changed the hearts of the Egyptians so that they gave the Israelites gold, silver, and cloth. This would later be used in the offerings the people gave in Exodus 25 to build the tabernacle. In 1 Chronicles 22, 6 through 16, David is told that he will not be the one to build the temple, but that it will be his son Solomon. David then begins accumulating the materials that Solomon will use to build the temple. In 2 Chronicles 24, 4 through 14, we see how God moved in the hearts of the people to provide an offering so that Joash can refurbish the temple. The offering was so great that Joash had to tell the people to stop giving. See, God can provide what's necessary because he can move in the hearts of his people to do so. In Nehemiah 2, 3 through 8, we see how God moved in the heart of King Artaxerxes, a pagan king, to provide the resources to rebuild the wall around Jerusalem. And similarly, in Ezra 1, 4 through 11, and 7, 11 through 28, we again see how God moved in the heart of a pagan king to provide the resources to rebuild the temple. J. Hudson Taylor once said, God's work done in God's way will not lack God's support. He is just as able to supply funds ahead of time as afterward, and he much prefers doing so. You know, God's ways are totally different from ours, as we saw in Isaiah 55, 7 and 8. My ways are not your ways, neither are my thoughts your thoughts, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts your thoughts. Any questions? Yes. Okay. 1 minute. All right. As I have studied the scripture, this is a topic. Not just tithing, but giving. Anytime the pastor started preaching on giving, as far as I was concerned, he went from preaching to meddling. But as I have studied this over the last 20 years, I have come to believe that God requires us to tithe. And I say that because the key passage on this, there's two really, is the Malachi chapter 3, starting with verse 8. You know, you are robbing God. And the people say, how we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. The whole nation of you. He said, test me now in this and see if I will not, you know, open the gates of heaven and pour out till it overflows. And I asked myself about that one. And I said, why is he calling not tithing? Because what he says is that tithing is robbing him. Why is that? Why is tithing robbing him? Because he's not accusing them of a violation of a commandment of tithing. He's accusing them of the violation of the commandment of stealing. Well, Leviticus 27:30, which is the first time tithing is mentioned in the law at all, it isn't given as a command. It says, the tithe is holy to the Lord. Whether it's the tithe of the grain, the tithe of the fruit, the tithe of the animals. It is holy to the Lord. It's just a fact of life. It is holy to the Lord. And I believe it's in Deuteronomy, he says, I have given the tithe of Israel to the Levites. Now, I want you to, which has an impact, because if tithe belongs to him, the only thing he gave to the Levites was Israel's tithe. Okay? There's an implication that Gentiles are to tithe, because it's a tenth, and it still belongs to him. Now, he never talks about that, but that's the implication of it. But I've had to deal with, you know, doing this for as long as I've done it. I deal with numerous, you know, things. Well, you know, we're not under the law, we're under grace. The tithe was basically in lieu of the tax because it was a theocracy, you know, that was to handle the temple and them. And, you know, it was a tax, and we don't have... Since we don't have a theocracy and we pay the taxes, it's in lieu of that. That's a position I've been told by one of my pastors, not one of my current pastors, one of my former pastors, that, you know, we don't have to tithe because we're not priests, we're not Levites, and a tithe was for them. So my thing covers all of those questions. But here's the thing. When you look at what Paul says is, you know, when you're not under the law but under grace, he defines what that means four times in the book of Romans. And never once does it mean you don't have to obey. The key is we're not under the law, we're under grace in that we are not under the penalty of the law. We are not under the condemnation of the law because Christ paid for that. God's moral law has never been set aside in the scriptures. Part of his law has been fulfilled through Christ. Part of his law has been set aside. Dietary laws were specifically set aside in Acts and in Colossians and others. So those don't apply, but his moral law has never been set aside. And that's why I think it was crucial when I looked at that Malachi passage over and over that it came to the conclusion. Their sin was not tithing. That was the evidence of their sin. Their sin was stealing. That was what he accused them of. And so I believe that the church today should still be tithing. Now, I go back to what I've already taught, God's role and our role. The real question is I have to ask myself, what would God do? It's his. Okay, I'm his steward. I should do what he would do. And I don't see God not tithing, since it would be stealing. So that's really the key, is it's a function of God's role and our role. Okay. Any other questions? I'm sure some won't agree, but my question is always, show me scripturally where we do not have to tithe. A lot of people will go to 1 Corinthians, or no, 2 Corinthians, 8 and 9. Because it's dealing with and saying that this replace the tithe. These are the principles that replace the tithe. And I'm saying, no, those aren't the principles that replace the tithe. It had nothing to do with the tithe. The principles given in there all had to do with raising a special offering for the church in Jerusalem. Everything in that is dealing with how, you know, they're raising the church funds for the offering in Jerusalem. It had nothing to do with tithing. That was an over and above offering. Okay, any more? Have I run over? Right on time. Okay, good. Thank you.